glad that you're here to celebrate with us. In fact, we're going to do it every Sunday.
All right.
Amen. It's good to see you today. I want to remind you very quickly, this is the afternoon, which we do our Journey 101 class, so make sure that you are signed up. If you haven't been through it, you're more than welcome to come. 4 o'clock today. I just need to know you're coming, so be sure and let me know, or Stacy know, or give me one of those cards that's out there on the table, and fill it out so we'll make sure we have plenty of workbooks and stuff. But I think we have about 10 or so that are coming to the class today, but there's room for some more. So come on, get on board. You can even join the church in this class if you want to join that way. So come be a part, see what God's doing at Believers Fellowship. Class really gets into the heartbeat of what this church is about, the vision and the direction the Lord has called us to. Amen? So come be a part of that. Also, I don't know if Tim mentioned it or not, but let me mention it again. Marriage retreat, second week's completely filled up. We can put you on a waiting list in case somebody does cancel, but I think there's still a spot or two left in the first week. So hope you got all that taken care of and settled. It's going to be a great, great time of the Lord. We are in a series we're calling Back to the Future, because the future is just around the corner. We call it Back to the Future because everything ahead of us has been prophesied behind us. The Bible, above all things, among all things, is a book of prophecy. It's filled with prophecy about the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ at his first coming, telling when, where he would be born, how he would be born, gave the times even, if you follow the book of Daniel, of when the Lord Jesus would be born, and the signs that would be prior to that, what he would do when he came, how he would live his life, how he would die, clear descriptions of his crucifixion and how he would be raised. And so there's lots of prophecy concerning the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ, but there's more prophecy than that even concerning the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. So that's what this series is about. Last week we did a brief overview of the study, and I shared this particular graph talking about how Jesus came from the Father's house, came, was born, and died for our sins, rose from the dead, and then 40 days after that time of his resurrection, he ascended into the Father's house. And now that the angels told the disciples gathered around, hey, this same Jesus will come again in like manner. In other words, just as he ascended into glory, he's going to descend into glory. So we talked about during this time, prophetically speaking, we call this a little period right now until the rapture and the Antichrist and tribulation begins. This is called the church age. You might call it the day of grace. It's a time when God has extended his mercy and his grace to all of us who will come by way of Jesus Christ to give our lives to him, experience salvation, so that we might spend the eternal ages with him. The end of this age will be marked by a couple of things. One is the rapture. That's a Latin word, meaning rapar, means to snatch away with a violent force, is what the word literally means. We don't find that word in the New Testament, but we do find words like blessed hope, the glorification of the saints. That all describes the time when the apostle John and also Paul talked about we'll meet him in the air. All right, so that's not the second coming of Jesus. All right, that's the taking away up from the planet all those who have died in Christ, where their bodies are resurrected, and all those who are still alive at that moment, they will be resurrected off the planet, and our bodies will be glorified. John put it this way: he said, "Beloved, you know, when we behold him, we'll be made like him." And so, there's coming that day that we call that the rapture, just as the terminology is given, a taking away. Now, the second coming is when he comes and places his feet, and the Battle of Armageddon is taking place, and he puts his feet on the Mount of Olives, and out of his mouth goes that two-edged sword. Armageddon comes to an end. That's the beginning of the thousand-year reign. During this time, before that, as the tribulation goes on the earth, is the believer's judgment. We talked about that last week, and we talk about how there's a season of great praise during that time. The marriage of the Lamb takes place. At the end of that seven-year period, somewhere, remember, down on the planet below, 7 years of tribulation has begun. It's marked by the Antichrist coming on the scene. And the Antichrist, he's a man of peace, supposedly. He's a very charismatic, global leader, well-respected. I believe he rises out of the European nations. He comes on the scene and does what nobody else has been able to do. He presents a seven-year peace treaty for the Middle East, which is signed by the Jews and the neighboring people of the world, and the United Nations ratifies it. And what that event does, that seven-year treaty, it marks the beginning, not of peace, but it marks the years, 7 years of hell on earth. Tribulation breaks out. Antichrist finally goes and declares himself, and I think part of that seven-year peace treaty, we'll talk about it in some other lessons as we go farther, but part of that seven-year peace treaty is that he gives the Jews the right to rebuild the temple on Temple Mount. And there's some things in Ezekiel and Daniel that lend to the fact that the Dome of the Rock, that Muslim mosque that's up there, doesn't have to be torn down. If you read Ezekiel, it looks like a little wall's been erected between those two things, and Ezekiel's prophesying the length and the height of what that wall would be. And as he's standing there talking about the temple reconstruction, and he says there's an angel, and he looks over and he beholds a profane place. That's most likely that dome of the rock that stands there today. So it's possible that both buildings can be established at the same time. I believe that's part of the treaty that the Antichrist makes. Now, all this goes to his head. He's possessed of the devil, who ultimately wants everything. It's his goal and his agenda to be God. In fact, he goes into the temple that's been reconstructed, and in the middle of the tribulation, he declares that he's God and everybody's going to worship him. And boy, then it then becomes what's known by in Israel and Daniel as the time of Jacob's trouble. It's the last 3.5 years of tribulation, and we'll talk a little bit about that in a moment. But all that goes on. This is allowed to go on for 7 years, and then we have the second coming of Jesus, all right? Armageddon kind of wraps this up. At the end of that millennial reign, Jesus comes. Satan's bound for 1,000 years. The judgment of the nations takes place. Jesus reigns on the seat of Jerusalem, on the seat of David in Jerusalem as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the President of all presidents, all right? The prime minister, amen? So he reigns as King of the world. For 1,000 years, this goes on, and we'll talk about that in a little moment and more in other sermons to come. But at the end of that 1,000 years, there's a revolt by the enemy as he's released from the pit one last time. And that revolt is ended quite suddenly by the grace of God. The last battle takes place. And then there's the great white throne of judgment. That's when all things are wrapped up and all the masses of the lost world gather before Jesus and see that his judgment is just. And they're cast in the lake of fire. And then we enter into the eternal ages. Now, Peter and others we read about last week talk about how this world is going to burn. There'll be a new heaven. There'll be a new earth. And a reestablishment of all things, and we eternally live with Jesus Christ forever and ever. So we're going to look at, starting this week and the next few weeks, at the signs of the times. Where we're at, what's going on in the world today, and how all these things were really specifically, in some cases, very specifically, you know, prophesied. The reconstruction of the nation of Israel. I mean, when that was given by Jesus in Matthew 24, we'll look at that passage in a moment. Israel wasn't a nation. Israel had gone into bondage, and Israel now was under dominion of Rome. And it was a province, but there was no national recognition and no national authority. They had none. They were a nation no longer. They'd been conquered by the Romans. And all that was prophesied, but they said Jesus prophesied the day would come when all that would change. Well, in 1948, it all changed. In 1948, we had the reestablishment of Israel as a nation. That's the first major sign that we watch. And we're going to spend about 2 weeks from now some time on Israel as a nation, what that means, how that happened, and what took place for all that to happen, and what's going to happen with Israel in the last day. So that's a whole new sermon. But I want us to realize the passage that we're looking from as we start realizing these principles and looking at these things, they all come out of Matthew 24 to start with, and then we're going to expand through Old Testament and New Testament from there. In Matthew 24, the disciples and Jesus are coming out of the temple. It says, and Jesus came out of the temple and was going away when his disciples came to point out the temple buildings to him. Like, these things are massive. These things are beautiful. Herod's temple was quite a constructor. I mean, it was beautiful. It was incredible. It was a reconstruction of what, when the temple was destroyed that Solomon built. They built on those Solomonic foundation stones around it and raised that thing high. It was draped with a crown of gold around it. It was magnificent. Herod was doing it with the Roman authority to rebuild the temple, hopefully to win the approval of some of the Jews, but that didn't go over so well. Amen. So they come out, and the disciples are raving about the building, and he answered and said to them, do you not see all these things? Truly, all this I say to you, not one stone here shall be left upon another, which shall not be torn down. And he was sitting on the Mount of Olives, and disciples came to him privately, saying, and when you're sitting on the Mount of Olives, those who've been to Israel will know that you're sitting there, and from the Mount of Olives you have a perfect view of Temple Mount. And they're looking at the temple, all right? And they're sitting there, and the disciples said, okay, privately, tell us, when will these things be? What will be the sign of your coming? And the end of the age. And Jesus answered and said to them, see to it that no one misleads you. For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and will mislead many. And you will be hearing of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not frightened, for all these things must take place, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And in various places there will be famines and earthquakes. Luke adds to this when he gives this speech that Jesus spoke. He says, pestilence. Famines and pestilence and earthquakes. But all these things are merely the beginning of birth pangs. Ladies, y'all know what birth pangs are, right? All right? They start mildly. They don't end mildly. But what you're seeing here is that this is just the beginning of it. Beginning of birth pain. Then they're going to deliver you to tribulation. And they will kill you, and you'll be hated by all nations on account of my name. So he says, what's going to happen in the end times? He's answering some questions. In fact, they ask him three questions. When shall these things be? And when's the temple going to be destroyed? And what shall be the sign of your coming? How can we know you told us you're going to go and you're going to leave us? He said, he'd already told him we're going to leave the Holy Spirit. You know, he already told him he's going to send to the Father. You know, everything's going on. He said, hey, how do we know that you're coming again? There were signs that accompanied his first coming. What are the signs accompanying your second coming? And what will be the signs of the end of the world or the end of the age? So they're asking some specific questions, which all of Matthew 24, he starts answering all those questions. You have to realize that as you go through that, some deal with the tribulation period, some deal with the time before the tribulation period, but he's answering. In fact, he said, the things leading up to that tribulation period, there'll be signs in global affairs, there'll be signs in religion, and there'll be signs that take place in the Middle East. That's the way, if you broke down all of Matthew 24 into different signs, this is the way they broke down. And what we're going to deal with today, and into probably next week as well, are the signs in global affairs. Then we're going to talk about signs in religion and the apostasy and the false Christ and all those things that will take place in the end times. And then we're going to talk in another sermon about Middle East and Israel uniquely and specifically. But today, he said, in the message we're dealing with today, he's dealing with the signs of global affairs. What are they? He says, there's wars and rumors of wars. But not only the wars and rumors of wars, there'll be famines. Not just famines, there's going to be pestilence, according to Luke 21 with this. Plagues and then earthquakes. Now, remember, he says, all these are just the beginning of birth pangs. We're going to talk about tribulation a little bit and some of the wars that will take place in the tribulation or the context of wars. But remember, these disasters of wars and famines and plagues and earthquakes, he says, these will take place in various places. Different places, different times, all over the world, that's going to be going on. When you get into the tribulation period, you know, when the white horse, which is the false Messiah, and the, you know, the four horsemen of the apocalypse, and the red horse, which is great war, and then the black horse, which is famine, and the pale horse, which is rampant sickness and death. Now, it's not just various places when it gets to, in Revelation, those places. It's all over the planet at one time. Ezra and Job and others talk about the whole earth would shake. Not just do we feel an earthquake in California or in Oklahoma like there was one recently, or in Thailand where there was an earthquake recently. The whole world's going to shake. So what we see now is the beginning of these birth pangs, or just things are happening. And it gets, as we get closer to Jesus, then they're escalated. More is happening more often and more radically in more places than ever. I would think today, as much as I have a lot of notes here, we're not going to get through all I have in my head, all right, unless y'all want to stay till this evening. So I won't do that to you. So I'm going to specifically focus on the wars and rumors of wars, where nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. And part of that is, when it talks about nations, it's dealing with nations and kingdoms. Another translation put it that nations will go against nations and races will be against races. So not only will there be national wars, but there'll be racial wars and racial tension and national tensions. On every level, there's conflict and there's chaos. And as we get closer to the time of Jesus Christ, the chaos is going to become more radical. It's like an exponential thing, just like with birth pangs, where they would start out mild and they're minutes apart. You know, eventually you get a minute apart and then seconds apart, and there's such pain that's it's coming at the same time. And nobody's going to be able to give the globe an epidural. In case you're asking for one. So as he deals with this, understand, it's a little bit at the beginning. Now, never before in history have we faced the possibility of wars like we face now. In fact, when you look at the wars and rumors of wars that are going on in verse 6, he says, don't be frightened for these things. They must take place. It's not the end, all right? It's going to be the end. It's going to be even in greater wars. So as he talks about this, you understand that the 20th century, this last century, we're now in the 21st century, but in the last century, of all the centuries that preceded the 20th century, there were a lot of wars, but there were never wars like began in the 20th century, you know, in the 1940s, and when we had World War I and World War II. In fact, in World War I, you know, historians recorded over 8 million people that lost their lives an actual result of the war itself. That's a lot of people to die in one war. And then that wasn't nothing. Let's do an exponential jump from 8 million to 50 million people that lost their lives in World War II. So we see that we're living, you know, in a culture which is now seeing these things advance more so than ever before. Let's add to that, we're in the 21st century. Think about what's going on around us right now and the mindset. I mean, you take into consideration the advances in technology, the expanding rate of terrorism. I mean, recently on the news, even this morning, last night, the power-hungry dictators that seem to be rising, as in Russia, as in North Korea. Add that the ongoing hatred of the Jewish people. Add to that the expanding godlessness of people and the godlessness of the nations. And you realize, you know, we're living in a time we could have such mass casualties and war, it would blow your mind. In fact, we have enough nuclear arsenals scattered around the world right now to kill every living person on this planet several times over. So we're living in dangerous time. Now, it kind of leads me to assume the potential for outbreak of war is imminent anytime, any place. World War III, I believe, is near. We would call it World War III. But there's been more people. Just give you an idea. Let's take 5,000 years of recorded history. And there's been a lot of history written and a lot of wars written and a lot of casualties been written down by historians through the ages. But if you realize just the last century, the last 100 years, there were more people killed in wars of the 20th century than all the wars of the past history combined. That ought to stagger us. In fact, the last 5,000 years of recorded history, there's been an estimated 600 million people that have died as a result of wars. But catch this. Half of those 600 million, which would be 300 million, half of those have died within the wars of the 20th century. Then you look around when it talks about wars and rumors of wars. You look at all the potential hotspots that are in Africa and Algeria and Sudan and Somalia and Eritrea and Nigeria, Rwanda, Zaire, Eastern Europe with Bosnia, Macedonia, Yugoslavia. All the threat now for the Russians putting back on Eastern Europe to retake some of those former Soviet republics. They want those back. You add to what's happening in the Far East with North Korea and the mindless dictator that's there and his continual threats to the rest of the peace-loving world. Add to that all the problems in the Middle East, Afghanistan and Iraq and Pakistan and Israel and Palestine, all the possible hotspots. Everything is just on edge in the world. Men cry peace, peace, as the Bible said prophetically would happen, but there is no peace. And let me add to that, there'll be no peace until Jesus comes because he's the Prince of Peace. What I felt like that just to kind of bring this home to us today and to help us understand that we really are living in the end times is to see what has happened in the world. But I also want to clarify what's getting ready to happen in regard to wars and what I believe is the very near future. So I've kind of compiled some things here today, and I just want to spend our whole time dealing with what I would call wars of the end times. What happens to us in the near future and what will happen in the wars of the book of Revelation and Daniel and Ezekiel, those wars that are mentioned very clearly. Wars that obviously, because of the nature of the nations that are listed in Scripture that would participate in those wars, shows that those wars haven't yet happened. All right, there are wars that the Bible mentions, and it signifies certain nations that will participate, other nations that won't participate. And so we can look at history and say, well, that the Bible predicts this war and prophesies a war, but none of these are it because these nations didn't participate. All right, World War I, World War II, Korean War, they didn't fall into these categories. All right, so we'll look at the wars that will possibly, most likely happen prior to that glorious appearing in the Blessed Hope. Or at least right after it, and somewhere in that range, but right before the Antichrist comes. It's kind of like the world is being prepared for Antichrist. The world is being prepared for somebody that will bring peace. I believe it was a man by the name of Janowicz. I'm not sure where he's from, but back in the 70s, I remember seeing this in the papers, that he stood up in the UN and said, what the world needs now more than any other time in history is for a peacemaker. And let him come. One man who will rule the world with peace. Let him come quickly. And everybody in the UN stood up and applauded. Well, the world's still looking for somebody that can bring peace to the troubled age and the troubled times and the trouble that the rest of the world is facing. It's hard for you, perhaps, if you haven't served in the military or even really not a person who keeps up with what's going on in the news, to know how tense the world really is. And know how the military always is standing ready in a moment to move forward in case something breaks out that threatens our national security. But the world is a very tense place today. And there are struggles every time, if you listen at all to the news, every time the news is given, there's a struggle, there's an outbreak of something happening immediately somewhere, or the threat of something getting ready to happen. We're living in the time of, like at no other time in history, the time that Jesus gives a description of the days right before he comes. So let's look at these wars of the end time. I think the next big war, and I really felt many years ago when I studied this, that this happened back in 67 and 70 when Israel was attacked by all the surrounding Arab nations that were around them. We'll call it, for better lack of terminology, the war of extermination in Psalms 83. In Psalms 83, mark this down, write it down, because you can go back and read. It's not a real long psalm, but a lot of this psalm deals with how that the immediate neighbors of Israel, those who are right on the borders, you know, you got Lebanon, you got Syria, you know, Egypt's just right there, all these neighboring countries, that they will gather together with one goal, as verse 4 says, to wipe out or the annihilation of the name of Israel. That happened back in the late 60s, early 70s, a couple of attempts to destroy Israel. The neighboring nations got around it, and Israel should have been annihilated by a series of miraculous events that we'll cover in the message when we talk about Israel, that they should have been destroyed. And that was the goal of those nations, was to drive Israel out of the country, and all it did was expand their borders some and give them a little bit more security. But these nations that are described as being part of this effort are those with common borders, according to Psalms 83 and verses 6 and 8. The rest of that psalm is a prayer for the victory of the nation of Israel in the process of that war. And although the outcome of that war is not necessarily stated, when you tie it together with all the other scriptures that deal with those events of the immediate neighbors of Israel, Israel comes out with more property and more territory and more security than what they had before. Bible talks about in the last days that Israel and Jerusalem specifically will become a trembling cup for the nations. It is so much a trembling cup that even the United States doesn't want to declare the capital of Israel as Jerusalem. We have our embassies in Tel Aviv. And many nations of the world, they won't do it. That fear of what's going to come out or what's going to happen. In Amos chapter 9, it talks about how the Jews will be reestablished in their land and will not be rooted out again from the land. Some believe that this war of 80, this Psalms 83 war, will result in a great territorial expansion that covers literally the boundaries of the Abrahamic covenant. When God in Scripture talks about what the boundaries of his promised people's land would be and declares those lands, some people believe that Psalms 83 will result in the restoration of all that territory and will provide a much greater security for Israel. You'll be shocked when we study that in the particular sermon, just about how insecure the nation of Israel really is and how the borders are so narrow and that the landmass in Harris County is probably bigger than the stated map landmass of Israel today. It's a tiny nation, but yet it becomes a cup of trembling. Now, there's something that happens as a result of this war, and it's in Ezekiel 38 and 39. A few years ago, I preached on Ezekiel 38, the Battle of Gog and Magog. And we looked at the neighboring nations and how they're described in Scripture and what the modern titles for those nations most likely would be, given by the geographical description of Ezekiel 38, when it talks about a great power and a bear to the north, and how if you stood in Jerusalem today and you look due north, you're staring at Moscow, even though it's thousands of miles away, it's Moscow, and how that modern-day Russia aptly fits the description of a nation where God says, "What that nation, I will put a hook in their jaw and drag them into the region." In other words, God's going to cause the hearts and the minds of Russian leaders to say, "Hey, let's go take Israel." I believe some of this, you know, is part of the nations, the Arab nations that will try to ally with Russia after this Psalms 83 war. That they won't be, you know, they lose here and they begin to invite some help. And of course, the Russians are very happy to respond, for they've always dreamed of taking the oil fields of the Middle East and having that riches there and welcome to them. And also, you know, they've wanted this warm water seaport the Mediterranean provides. So they launch an invasion. This power to the north is called this Great Bear, which is the symbol of Russia, by the way. They launch an invasion with the stated intent externally of helping the Arab nations, but their intent is a little bit different, you know. They use this as an excuse to invade and to expand their sovereignty within the Middle East region. You know, after Afghanistan demise with the Russians in the 70s and that period of time when they fought in Afghanistan, they didn't do well and ended up pulling out and tucking their tail and leaving the region. They haven't been really involved in much of the Middle East in that point in time. But there's going to come a time when God will put it in their heart and their mind to go down into the Middle East. This war describes that time. And even already now, it seems that Russia is starting to exercise its little muscles into the Middle East region. Remember clearly in history that when nations went to war or involved themselves in war, it was for one reason and for one reason only. That's for domination. That's for conquest. That's the mindset. It wasn't until America and the church being established and it being raised up and America coming on the scene that the mind and the intent, at least for this part of the world, became different from the rest of the world whose mindset was conquest. Let's take more territory. We came with an attitude, let's bring freedom. You know, let's learn people that they can be democratic nations and learn how to solve their problems and, you know, have leadership that's qualified and will lead the people in a right way. So please understand that when America considers war, it considers it from a completely different aspect than what the nations of the Middle East and Far East consider war as. It's always for one reason. What are we going to get out of this? How are we going to gain from this? How are we going to prosper from this? So when Israel talks about going into Syria, such as they are, you can be sure there's more involved than what meets the eyes or helping out Mr. Assad, whatever the situation might be. They always have an underlying current, such as you see in the Ukraine. When I deal with pastors over in the eastern part of Europe and that far eastern part of Europe, everyone will tell you straight up, we believe the Russians are going to come back in. We believe that they are discontented with losing all those republics and all those nations and all those countries, and they're going to come back in and they're going to seek to reclaim. Well, we've seen them already doing that in the Ukraine, and most of the rest of them around the Baltic area believe they'll be coming for them again. But what happens in Ezekiel 38, this battle here, these armies, as they come in, God intervenes in Ezekiel 38 and 39. You see him moving in such a way as the enemy comes to capture and to plunder and to take goods, these invading armies are met with the presence of God. God does something unique. And the Bible talks about in Ezekiel 38 how there's this war and there's this devastation from fire and brimstone. It almost looks like a limited nuclear holocaust, especially when you follow the description of having to clean up after the war. That it takes 7 years to deal with the bodies and with the implements of war and for all those things to be dealt with in a proper way. What are they doing? They're trying to cleanse the land of all the radiation, all the poison that's going on. But however it happens, in the midst of all this deliverance that God brings while the nations surround them on every mountain of Israel and it looks like sheer annihilation, God intervenes. And it seems at this point, when the Bible talks about a Jewish revival, that they begin to open their eyes and look to Messiah and see that Jesus is their answer. It could well be in here that this is when that first spiritual movement begins as they see a supernatural deliverance, that the Jews begin to turn again to God. The Jews are not turning to God today. There's an Orthodox movement of Judaism in Israel, but the major part of the population are secular. They're not spiritually minded. They're not Jesus-minded. They're not Jehovah-minded, all right? They're self-minded. And many of them, you know, the whole context of being safe in the land, that's their religion. You know, Zionism is the religion. What will happen in this time, according to Ezekiel, that this could well be the time Revelation talks about as well, when the 144,000 Jews come to know Christ and Jesus is the Messiah, and they're sealed by the Lord for special service, the Bible talks about, that God's going to use them, that 144,000, throughout the tribulation to continue. Even while Satan's wreaking havoc on earth, God's continuing through mercy and grace to get the message of hope out and salvation out. Now, a lot of people, when they look at this war, it's always concerned with timing. When is this going to be? Does it have to come? Is it going to come before the tribulation, before the rapture? When's it going to come? I think it probably, just in my mindset, trying to lay things out on a kind of a timetable, as you're laying all these events out, somewhere prior to the Great Tribulation, all right? It's going to take the Jews 7 years to clean up the mess, or maybe about 3.5-4 years out before the tribulation begins, because 3.5 years into the tribulation, about 7-8 years later, it's going to be hell on earth. You know, for the Jews, this Antichrist declares himself to be God there. All right? So does it mean the war of Psalm 83 and Ezekiel 38 must occur before the rapture? I don't think so. I think they could occur tomorrow. That's how difficult and radical the world is. But I do believe that the rapture could occur at any time. Before that, after that, in about the same time of that. Remember, It's not the rapture, that taking away of the church, that marks the beginning of the tribulation, really. It's the 7-year peace treaty that the Antichrist makes. Now, this certainly, when you think about this wars, I mean, this Middle East tension of Psalms 83 and all the crisis from Ezekiel 38 and 39, all the crisis of the death, the loss, I mean, somebody needs to have a peace plan. Well, guess what? There's a guy, obviously, somewhere out of the European countries, Rome or wherever, who rises to the occasion as this incredible genius peacekeeper who comes with this great plan, and the Jews sign this deal with him, and the other Arab nations surrounding all sign this deal for peace to come. But it really doesn't mark peace at all. So there's this platform laid for this guy to step on the scene in the midst of all this crisis. People are looking for answers. The tribulation begins soon when the Antichrist signs that security agreement with Israel that Daniel 9 even talks about. Now, what happens is, we know in the book of Revelation, the four horsemen of the apocalypse, in Revelation chapter 6, the red horse of war is released. And what you see is a conventional war, not necessarily nuclear here, but a conventional war that breaks out. The book of Revelation states that a major world war will break out soon after the tribulation. Revelation 6 begins to describe this. The Antichrist, all right, remember, he's risen to world authority. He's accepted by many people in the world. In Europe and many of these other parts of the world, his cunning, his deception, his ability, his intrigue, according to Daniel 8, that's not going to be enough, though, to take authority over the world. That's not going to be enough to seize what he wants to seize. Remember, the Antichrist is possessed by the devil himself. He wants to seize the planet. He wants it all for himself. And not only is he satisfied with that, he wants the kingdom of God. He wants the throne of God. He wants the heavens and the earth. But there are countries in the world today who will not respond to him no matter how crafty he is. There's a lot of nations in the world in Asia and Africa and South America who spent far too long under the dominance of European nations and European colonialism. They're not going to suddenly surrender to somebody who comes out of Europe and says, hey, I'm here and I'm God. They're not going to receive it no matter how charismatic and brilliant he may be. So we're told in Revelation chapter 6, there's the beginning of war. And we're told in Revelation 13, the Antichrist will ultimately, he's going to achieve authority over every tribe, and he's going to have authority over every people and every tongue and every nation. How does he get that? The picture is laid out in Revelation chapter 6 when the war begins. It records the outbreak of a war that results in the death alone of 1/4 of humanity. You figure the globe, what, 4, 5, 6 billion people? We're talking about 1.5 billion people in today's term that lose their life in this particular war, as Antichrist wages war in the world. Now, what happened, remember, in Psalms 83 was that destruction of a lot of destruction of that inner ring of those Arab and Muslim states who were around Israel. The war of Ezekiel 38 and 39 deals with countries just in the outer ring of that. When you look at all the countries that are mentioned in Ezekiel 38 and 39, all right? So those, have been tremendously affected. But you have to realize the vast majority of the Muslim world, they live outside that ring of influence there, that inner ring and outer ring. So the war of Ezekiel 38 and 39 produces the defeat of those immediate influences that Muslim aggression against Israel. You can call it an Arab aggression, but it really is a Muslim aggression that rejects Jesus and rejects his authority and rejects his headship over the world. They deny the death of Jesus. They deny the resurrection of Jesus. They're the ones who came up with the theology years ago that says he was courted away in the middle of the night by his disciples. So they don't acknowledge him and his lordship. They just say he was a good prophet. And Islam declares basically for the global authority. But guess who else wants global authority? The Antichrist. So there's a conflict. There's this conflict between Antichrist and the Western world, the Far East world, and the Muslim, all right? So the nations but are most likely to resist him will be those other Muslim nations. You have to realize that in Indonesia, there's over 200 million Muslims. In India, there's 144 million plus Muslims. In Pakistan, there's 140 million Muslims. In Bangladesh alone, there's 115 million. Those are that far outer circle. So those people are going to have to be dealt with by Antichrist. In other words, I believe God's going to use the Antichrist as his hammer of wrath, ultimately, to destroy Islam. But yet he still needs to be destroyed himself. The Antichrist does. So this looks like a conventional war. But when you follow this, it seems to morph into another war, what looks like a nuclear war when you get into chapter 8 and 9. At some point, it seems that this the Revelation book seems to indicate that this conventional war, it kind of moves towards a Holocaust, nuclear Holocaust type of war that results in the death of another one-third of mankind. Another 1.5 million people die. Billion people. So we're looking around 3 to 4, 3.5 billion people now that lose their lives. This means that the first two wars, the tribulation, the conventional war, and this nuclear war of Revelation 8 and 9, you know, they just annihilate, you know, tremendous, more than half of humanity. Now, the hint that this kind of thing, this war kind of moves into a nuclear format and it becomes one that's you know, not a conventional war, is in Revelation 8, where it states that the escalation of the war will result in one-third of the earth being burned up as well. So there's a great fire, which in all this is they look at it, and you look in Revelation 16, and it talks about also that malignant, loathsome sores break out on people and afflict the people at the end of the tribulation. That's the natural consequence of a nuclear Holocaust that takes place. It could well be that this nuclear Holocaust be what Jesus had in mind when he said, in the end times, men will faint from fear over the expectation of things to come upon the world. In Luke 21, he says, they will be fearful because the world and the powers of heaven will be shaken. This war is portrayed in the book of Revelation in chapters 8 and 9 as the series of trumpet judgments. Then what comes immediately after this, in the description of what looks like nuclear war, Satan poses another war in the book of Revelation. It's called the War of the Heavens, we'll call it. In Revelation chapter 12, you know, it seems that this war has is the next one in line, and it is war. It's all out war, but it's not of the same nature as these other wars mentioned. It's a supernatural war. It apparently takes place in the heavens in the middle of the tribulation. It's most likely prompted by an attempt of Satan to once again, as he did before, remember, he had one-third of heaven revolt against God, and he tried to take God's throne. Again, he will make his move to depose God from the throne, unsuccessfully. And at this point, Satan and his angels are opposed by, the Bible says that Michael and his angels, he's kind of the commander-in-chief over the angels, at least. He's in charge at this point. And in Hebrews scriptures, it refers to him having this authority. In Daniel 10 and Daniel 12, it talks about how Michael and the angels prevail in this war, and Satan is cast down to the earth. And his access to God's throne is completely cut off in Revelation chapter 12. Now you say, what do you mean? Remember in the book of Job, it says that Satan had access. He'd go into the throne of God. In fact, today, I don't think it's any different until this point when he's completely cut off. He has access. The Bible calls him what? The accuser of the brethren. Well, who's he accusing him? He's always accusing us before God. He's always looking for the fault. He's always looking for that. Hey, but who can bring any accusation before God's elect? Because the ultimate judge is God and Jesus himself. Amen? But that entrance and that access is going to be completely destroyed. And in his rage, he decides, hey, I'm going to inflict my rage out upon the Jewish people and upon all the folks, which leads to the next war, which is in Revelation 12. Kind of looks like it kind of leads into this war, which is a war against the Jews and the saints. And Satan obviously hates the Jews. It doesn't take much of history reading to see how he hates the Jews. You can look at the birth of Jesus. You see how that an attempt to kill Jesus and to stop his work, that all those babies in Bethlehem killed. You can go back to the Egyptian Exodus when we wanted to stop the promise of a Savior and the promise of a Jewish, you know, of a Jewish Messiah and a Savior. Satan attempts to kill all those baby Jews that are being born in Egypt, and the massacre takes place. You see it's over and over again, so that Moses is put in a basket as a baby to protect his life. Satan has always hated the Jews. Why? Because God made a covenant with Abraham. And God's going to enforce that covenant. They're chosen people. And God uses them to provide. Well, I'll tell you one thing. You better be glad for the Jewish people. However you feel, you wouldn't have this book. God used the Jewish people to give us this book. It was through the Jewish people that God gave us his promised son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And God has promised that he'll bring a great remnant of those Jews, that 144,000, in the last days to a faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and protect them through the tribulation so they can carry the gospel around the world. Now, but in this war against the Jews, there's going to be a Holocaust probably greater than the last Holocaust that took place. The latter half of the tribulation when he cast down the earth and his inspiration is to do one thing, to kill the Jews. That's why in Scripture, in Daniel and other places, this part of the tribulation, the last half of the tribulation, is the time of what's called Jacob's trouble. the Jewish people's troubles. And there'll be many that'll be protected this time, but many, many are going to die. It's at this time that, according to Scripture, that many of them will flee the security of Israel because they won't feel secure anymore. And they'll flee to a place in Jordan is the actual description of geographically of where they flee. Many of you have been to Israel, and some of you that have gone with us, maybe on one of our trips we went to Petra. Petra is that place, and it's a box canyon, basically, that could hold thousands and thousands of people. It's very defensible on every side. And it's an accurate description location-wise as well as physically descriptive-wise of where they will go, and they will hide in the rocks and flee to a place in the wilderness that it talks about in Revelation chapter 12, and they'll be protected by God. A lot of people believe that's the city of Petra. There's a good reason for that assumption, because in Daniel chapter 11, it says the Antichrist will be prevented from conquering Jordan. That's one country that they just won't be able to conquer when it's the end time rebellion comes. But as you follow this through in this war that goes on, the last half of the tribulation, in Zechariah 13:8, it indicates that about two-thirds of the Jewish people will die at the hands of the Antichrist during this time. All right? It's called also not only a war against Israel, it's called a war against the offspring of Israel. Who would that be? Those who honor God. Those who are the Christians that are getting saved in the time of tribulation. They lose their life as martyrs for Christ. It's no wonder in Revelation chapter 7, when John is standing with the angel and being told what would take place in the days ahead, as he stands there, he sees this great multitude of people worshiping around the throne of God. And he says, so much so they couldn't be numbered. And the angel, when he asked, who are these? He said, these are the ones coming out of the great tribulation, the time of Jacob's troubles. For they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Revelation chapter 7. So he gives a description of all those people that will come out of these wars and survive, you know, by the grace of God. They die physically, but survive spiritually in heaven. So the Antichrist, if you look at the numbers, he seems very successful in his war against the Jews. And he seems very successful in his war against the saints. But he will fail completely in his goal of annihilating them all. For we're told repeatedly throughout the Word of God that there will be a great remnant that God saves until the end of the tribulation, which will receive at the end of the tribulation Yeshua, Messiah, as their King and as their Lord. That's in Isaiah 10 and Zechariah 12 and Romans chapter 9, Romans chapter 11 as well. So there's this war that's going on to annihilate them. There's another war that takes place. You say, man, isn't that enough? We call it the Middle East campaign of the Antichrist. You say, what do you mean? In Daniel chapter 11, it describes another war, a military campaign of the Antichrist in the Middle East that occurs towards the end of the tribulation. This is kind of right prior before you get to Armageddon. These verses indicate that when Antichrist becomes totally obsessed with destroying Jews and the saints, the nations of the world see this as an opportunity against him. They're tired of this. He brought nothing but sorrow and death and demise to the world and to the globe. It talks about in the scriptures there the king of the north, which is most likely Syria, the king of the south, which is Egypt. Now they consolidate with some forces. They say, hey, we've got to fight the Antichrist now. They see what's going on. And it says that the Antichrist responds and uses this terminology in scripture. He invades the beautiful land. And he subdues all the area there except Jordan again. But just as it seems as he's completely victorious, the Bible says that as he's reigning and stomping out these countries, that he hears of rumors from the east and from the north that deeply disturb him. And what he does, it says that he comes and he retreats with his armies to an area between the seas. And that's speaking specifically, I believe, of the Mediterranean, the Sea of Galilee, which we refer to as Megiddo, the Valley of Megiddo, which we might be more in term with Armageddon. So he retreats to these plains, and they're beautiful plains, this massive area of flat land. That there it says, when he gets there between the seas, the Bible says, there he comes to his end. And it's a great description geographically of the area we're talking about, the Valley of Megiddo in Israel. What happens? He's again in war, destroying these Arab nations now completely. No analysis here. Does what he's always intended to do. He destroys them. They're trying to resist. Meanwhile, armies from the east. The Bible talks about a Chinese army that crosses the dry Euphrates by the millions. They come into the same valley, all right? They bring huge armies from Asia. and they're ready to cross into Israel and challenge him. The rumors of the north could relate to a reconstituted kind of rebellious army that now doesn't want Antichrist either, that Gog. And you know, so we call it, you know, it leads to this next battle as they all gather there to fight to the battle of Armageddon. Joel 3, Zechariah 14, Revelation 19. It appears that just as these armies from the east, the north, arrive, Valley of Armageddon, we're going to challenge the Antichrist. This is the moment when the Lord breaks from heaven. Here now we have the glorious appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord breaks from heaven. He puts his foot on the Mount of Olives. And not too far from there, the voice is heard. He speaks. The two-edged sword goes out of his mouth. The Bible says with the breath of his mouth in 2 Thessalonians. The Battle of Armageddon. By the way, the Battle of Armageddon is not a very long war. All right? It's over in an instant. They've all gathered. Everybody's ready to go, but the Bible says at this point in Zechariah 14, it says that there's going to be massive destruction of life. In fact, these people are going to be so confused, they're going to kill each other in the process. That's where we have those descriptions of the blood rising to the reins of the horses. It's just a bath of blood. In fact, it says that God releases this plague. It's like a wasting disease that's described in Jeremiah and Isaiah 10, where it causes the flesh to literally fall off the soldiers while they're standing on their feet, and that their eyes will rot out from their sockets and their tongues will rot in their mouth. It clearly is an accurate description, not of a nuclear bomb, but of a neutron bomb. This is the effects of the neutron bomb, they say. So what happens is, boom, like the explosion takes place. And it's over. And it begins the time of a thousand-year reign of the Lord Jesus Christ on the earth. He's come back now. Who came with him? Everybody who's in heaven. The saints have already come back for their glorified bodies during the rapture. Now we're coming back with him in this moment. And mercifully for the planet and joyfully for the saints, the Battle of Armageddon is followed by 1,000 years of peace in the reign of Jesus Christ from Jerusalem. And the world now begins to experience what it means to be living in the presence of righteousness and justice and judgment. And the Lamb of God reigns on the throne of God. The Bible tells us that the swords will be beat into plowshares and the spears will be beat into pruning hooks. In other words, think for a moment. All the masses of billions and trillions of dollars that over the last years alone that the nations have invested in armaments and weapons and tanks and bombs and planes and ships and bullets and everything else. All that money will not be spent on that anymore. There's a time of peace like the world has never known. In fact, the Bible describes in Amos time a time where the world is flooded with an agricultural abundance. There won't be homeless people during the thousand-year reign. There won't be hungry people during the thousand-year reign. Everybody's going to be fed. According to Micah, it says every man will have his own vineyard and his own orchard. In other words, everybody's going to have what they need during this time. Satan is going to be bound for this 1,000 years. Sin and crime will be radically reduced. But there's still something going on. There's this seething rebellion in the hearts of many people, even during this time, if not most of the people, that are born during this 1,000-year reign. Because people still on the planet are going to be procreating. They'll be marrying. They'll be having children. The prophets tell us that the average lifespan during the millennium at least will be 100 years for everybody, and many, many, much more than that. The initial population of the millennium will be all those Jews and all those Gentiles who actually lived to the end of the tribulation and who accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. That's the initial population. But realize, 1,000 years is a long time. And those people are going to have babies. But the problem is, in the millennium, just as it is in this day and age, everybody that's born during that time is going to have a sin nature. They're going to have sin nature. And even though Jesus reigns on the throne, and even though the kings of the earth are going to pay their homage and to honor God, even though the nations of the world surrender to him, this population of people is going to begin to exponentially grow over this 1,000 years of time, along with this extended life rate. And so those people still born with the old sin nature, they're going to have those old sin desires. But it's not going to be easy to go find some pornography on the internet. It won't be there. And it's not going to be so easy, because all these things and the justice of God and judgment of God that have plagued mankind and ruined mankind and destroyed their lives and their families and their homes, it's all going to be illegal. And you, my dear friends, will be sitting in the courtrooms. The church, the Bible says, will be the judges on the ends of the earth, to the ends of the earth, during this millennial reign. You'll be given authority to stand and rule the nations, the Bible says, under Jesus' authority. There'll be immediate arrest followed by immediate trials and immediate judgment. There's not going to be appeals because all the judges are the saints and glorified bodies. And I can guarantee you there's not one corrupt judge in that bunch. There's not one unjust judge in that bunch. There's not one unfair judge in that bunch. And despite the fact that this thousand-year reign produces such righteousness and fairness and perfect judgment on the planet, most of those people living in the flesh will deeply resent the fact they can't pursue their worldly lust freely anymore. What's going to happen? Remember, Satan's been locked up for 1,000 years. At the end of that 1,000 years, when he's released at the end of the Lord's millennial reign, Revelation 20, majority of those in the flesh are going to unite in one last rebellion against God, and it's pictured in Revelation chapter 20, verses 7 and 9. And it seems that this battle, we'll call it the last battle of the ages. It's really the second battle of Gog and Magog, because it does mention that somehow they make it through again, and they rise up and revolt with the devil this time. Gog and Magog. You know, sometimes this war is often confused with the battle in Ezekiel, but this is clearly a different war than the one in Ezekiel. Russia coming against the nation of Israel with certain specified allies is one war. Then this northern powers, Russia, whoever it is, coming against God and Jesus Christ at the end of times, they don't have those allies. It's just them and the Antichrist, along with rebellious humanity. One of the many purposes, by the way, of this millennial period, why do we do this millennial thing? The only purpose is really to prove that mankind's inherent defect, sin nature, cannot be remedied by anything but the Holy Spirit and by the power of God working in an individual. Remember, the religion of Satan has always been humanism, all right? That's the religion he promotes everywhere all the time. Humanism is the basic idea and belief that man in itself is inherently good, and if you educate him enough, give him a good job, give him a good way to make money, then he's going to be okay. You know, and that's humanism. I call it the Gene Roddenberry Star Trek philosophy. You know, if you ever followed the philosophy of the Star Trek shows and movies, it always had that one humanistic theme that's always resounding clearly through it. Hey, we're going to evolve, you know. We're going to be evolved, and we're not going to be greedy anymore, and we're not going to be war-oriented anymore. We're going to be the perfect group of people. The planet Earth, you're going to be populated with people who understand each other now, and we all just naturally know the importance of caring for one another, and we've united our hearts, and you know, we're not manipulated by greed or adultery or any of those things anymore. You know, we're just that perfect culture. Because why? Because we've been educated and we understand social justice and we've been taught, and we just realize that we've given everybody a guaranteed place in the structure of the world. Everybody has a guaranteed job, everybody has an income, so everybody's going to be happy. And there's not going to be more war. The Bible teaches, though, it's completely different. Humanism says that you can do it yourself. The Bible teaches you can't. The Bible says you're flawed with a sin nature. And that's the reason that people are evil. And that's the reason people lie. And that's the reason people cheat. Jeremiah 17 talks about a heart that's desperately wicked. Who can know it? And the Bible teaches there's only one way to be changed, and that's through salvation in Jesus Christ, accepting the Lord as your personal Savior. And what's going to happen with this thousand-year reign, God is going to prove that beyond a doubt, when he puts man, all of man, into the perfect society, where everybody's going to have everything they need for 1,000 years, they still respond in rebellion. They still act the same way. Why? Because of the sin nature. Only one solution to the problem for any of us, and that's to surrender our heart and our life to Jesus Christ, or we will always be bound by that. And God will prove by this millennial reign, beyond any shadow of doubt, you can put man into the perfect society for 1,000 years, give him everything he needs, have peace, no wars, and he still responds in rebellion. But when it's all said and done, eternal peace is coming. In Luke 21, when Luke is describing this discourse, what they call the Olivet Discourse, where Jesus is talking about the end times, Jesus gives this implicit warning in Matthew as well as Luke. He said, listen, the end of time is coming, and Lord, there's going to be wars. And the implicit warning there is you don't be terrified. Don't be terrified. When God talks to his saints about the tragedy of the end times, don't be terrified. Don't be terrified, because I have this thing under control, and everything's going to happen as I said it will happen. But I want you to know the significance of what he said 2,000 plus years ago is clearer today than it's ever been, especially in regard to this one prophecy alone. There'll be wars and rumors of wars, and understand that's just the beginning of the birth pangs. Because the wars that are going to come are going to be drastic and severe and radical. All these things are the beginning of birth pangs. Well, what are birth pangs? Anybody want to give me an accurate description? I think most of you know. They start mildly. In fact, you might be having to think, oh, these are birth pangs. And then you call the doctor. He said, no, those aren't birth pangs. Those are Braxton Hicks. So who's Braxton Hicks? I don't care who they are. Just get rid of the pain. Did they have them? Let me know about them. Those are faux birth pangs. Hey, 2,000 years ago, we went through the faux birth pangs. Now we're in the birth pangs. Now things are getting worse. Now things are reaching the climaxes. Now things are exponentially just going radical. But then it's going to really, he said, now then it won't be just in various places, then it's going to be global. That's the tribulation. Every one of us, folks, listen carefully to me. Every one of us in this room, one way or the other, we're going to see all this take place. Every one of us are going to stand at the great white throne of judgment, and every human being that's ever been born is going to stand at the throne of God. And they're going to see the justice of God, and they're going to see the fairness of God, and they're going to see the rightness of God. And they're going to see that God was right all along, and man's been wrong. And his warped thinking and his warped nature have caused him to make stupid decisions. It's been failed and flawed. They're going to see the demise of the enemy. In fact, there'll be those standing around at that moment who say, when Satan is brought before all that, and they said, is that him? It's kind of like, I expected more. You know, there's got to be more to this deal. Is that him? We see the glory and the majesty of Jesus. What a moment that's going to be. You know, I know National Back to Church Sunday here, this is kind of a hard message to preach. It's like, man, I feel pretty good before I got to church, man. that's some heavy stuff. You know, that's some strong stuff. This is reality, folks. But we're not pessimists, we're the optimists. Because why? We're on the winning side. It's pretty easy to be happy when you're on the winning side. Let's remember, give your life to Jesus, point one. Live your life for Jesus, point two. Hallelujah. Coming back with Jesus, point three. Hallelujah. Forever living with Jesus, the rest of it. That's worth praising the Lord for. But I think it's important that we need to know the times. The Bible says of the Old Testament, says it talked about the men of Issachar. It says they were men who understood the seasons, understood the times. I have a feeling today there's a lot of Christians who don't understand the times that we're living in. They don't see how things are unfolding rapidly, rapidly before us every day. We need to be aware of what's going on. We need to be excited about what's going on. We need to be in the life-saving business. We need to get all the lifeboats out we can and all the life-saving equipment we can gather up and start bringing people into the kingdom, reaching people for Christ. Loving people to Jesus, letting them know there's hope, there's life, not just from the drastic, terrible things that are coming, but from the miserable things in their life right now. God's a God of grace. He wants to bring life and peace where there doesn't seem to be any. You trust him with your life. You give your heart to Jesus. You follow him. If you haven't done that, listen, I don't have any good news for you. You know, there's nothing to look forward to. But if you give your life to Jesus, I got a lot of good news. Lots of good stuff to look forward to in your life. Let's stand with our heads bowed.